deliberation or action upon any matter within the scope of the governmental body's policymaking duties. Meetings shall not include a gathering of members of a governmental body for purely ministerial or social purposes when there is no discussion of policy or no intent to avoid the purposes of this chapter. So in essence, it's not a meeting that's purely ministerial or social. Easy enough, right? But what does ministerial or social mean? Let's start with ministerial. So a ministerial function are those functions, quote, performed by a governmental body which do not involve an exercise of discretion or judgment. And so this includes signatures, approval on documents, rudimentary things that you would do in the course of your employment. And then it also includes what a category that I call receipt of information. This is when the board takes in information as a group. And we know from either administrative rulings or court rulings some specific things that you're able to do as a board that are deemed ministerial. So this is when all three of you or two of the three of you are present. We know that you're able to attend the our access volunteer orientation. We know that you're able to gather to hear the results of a hired consultant where you look at a preliminary draft report and ask clarifying questions. We know that you're able to gather with me and receive legal advice. And we know that you're able to gather and discuss strategy for non-union employees. The reason, well, this is provided by a code section. Union employees are covered by the closed session portion of an open meeting. So we know that there are these times when legally you're able to get together as a quorum and perform ministerial functions as a board. How about social functions? Well, you're able to gather socially, to spend time together for friendly companionship. So if, you know, if you're having a cup of coffee or you're at the water cooler and you're talking about your families, you're able to do that. You're able to go to a social event together. Just remember that that ministerial and social are specific functions, and the caution that I would give the board is that you want to make sure you never intentionally or unintentionally involve into a meeting. And I know that all of you would intentionally do that. But unintentional evolution into a meeting is always a concern. And that could be a situation where it starts out as ministerial and then through natural discussion about non-policy subjects, it would evolve into that. So it's just something as a board member to keep in mind and govern yourself accordingly. So if it's not a social or ministerial function, then we know that when the three, the four of you are together, that it's going to be a meeting under our code. And there are 12 reasons in Iowa Code Section 21.5 that allow you to go into closed session. You never have to go into closed session, but there are these 12 closed session exceptions. And really the crux of the closed session exceptions, and I'm happy to talk about any if you want to, but I'll try not to dive into it too deeply at this point, is to be able to protect the county entity from liability. So for example, one of the or detriment the county entity. So one of the exceptions is discussing personnel matters in public, and sometimes that can be problematic from an entity liability perspective. If we would say things in the public forum that would be either confidential and protected or would be defamatory in some way, that could subject the county to potential liability. Also, real estate transactions are one of the closed session opportunities that the board has. And that, if we didn't go into closed session when we're trying to buy or sell real estate sometimes, and we're talking about what we want to offer, how much money we have, that could detriment us if we're trying to negotiate a price with someone. They could say, well, we know that you have up to $2 million for this, and that's just a hypothetical. So when you're offering me 1.1, no. And so those are times when the board can consider going into closed session. And my office is always happy to be involved in those decisions. and come to the board with requests for closed sessions. I do that from time to time when we have an litigation. Any questions about closed session? I wanted to touch on electronic meetings. Iowa code allows for electronic meetings, and that's section 21.8 of the code. And this is allowed when it's impossible or impractical for a quorum of people to be together in person. So an example would be that someone's, a board member's traveling and maybe someone else's car breaks down and we can't all get together, but we have 24 hours notice and we can all appear via phone. And we can notify the public of that. And what we've done in the past for electronic meetings is we've had them same place, same time available for the public to hear on speakerphone. So those are things that are available when we have circumstances that occur that make it so that we can't all be together in person. An evolving area of open meetings law that I keep a close eye on, and I think we'll see to continue as technology continues, is communication with technology. So it's possible for any governmental body to violate open meetings laws when they're using technology. And one way is group emails, which I hate group emails. And you'll get this all the time where people email you and include all three of you, and then you'll see people replying all. And you guys do a great job of this, if someone replies, not all of you replying and not you guys communicating together. But just remember that. I think one thought would be you could reply directly to the person, not reply all. Or if you see that one of your board members has replied all, then just kind of watch that and not reply all. When I send communication to the three of you, I try, but I'm not always successful at putting don't reply all, although that's a little different because it's privileged communication. But that's just something to be thinking of when you're getting emails together. Texting, same thing. You could violate open meeting by doing that. If you do decide to do that, then just remember to not let it evolve into those areas that we talked about. And there are different ways that this is going to play out. For example, social media and all the things that are coming down the pipe that we can't even envision. So anytime you're communicating with each other, just be sure that you're in that ministerial or social capacity.
I'm bad at this. This is one I struggled with, and I hit that reply all because that has been I've been used to. Fortunately, I don't think there's been any problems. Okay.
No. I think you've all done an excellent job of handling this. It's something to just keep in mind because you're busy. You're working hard in a bunch of different things. You all have a lot of duties and obligations, and so keeping those things in mind and working. I wish you didn't have any email or any texting or any social media as your attorney, but that's impractical, and that's not the way that our world functions today. The other thing I would just say is that you're also always potentially creating an open record, and so my suggestion is that you only use your county email for county purposes, and that any private accounts never be used for county board or county matters. So thanks for giving me a chance to get on my
show. Absolutely. Thanks, Jess.
I'll trade you on a flash drive, I'm sure.
So since this board has been together, while we're waiting on you to get your flash drive, and so since this board has been together, we've got a couple really good examples. So what I hear is when more than two of us are together, two or more of us are together, it has to be either a meeting, an open meeting, a closed meeting, or a non-meeting. Otherwise, we're in violation of something. And we actually have demonstrated all three. I don't remember if we've had a closed meeting, but we've had clearly open meetings where we're all together. We've had meetings. We've had what I believe are non-meetings that we posted notice to. We've had non-meetings like where we've received information that we didn't post notice four. And we actually changed one. So one that the county has done traditionally for years is we've had a meeting with our insurance provider to provide us with information about our insurance. No policy, no deliberation, no real discussion. And this year, Loris, primarily because you were concerned about it, we changed the way we handled that. And I attended that meeting with County Attorney Reynolds, Alyssa Wignall, Deb Shildroth, and our insurance provider, I think that was it, where we received the detailed information, but it was just information. Marty and Loris didn't share that information, and we'll have a appropriate for the public presentation that will come to you guys. Is that next week or is it 2 weeks?
28th.
On the 28th. So, I mean, we've got, just in our short time together, I think we've got examples of all of this.
Go on the left side.
Sorry. It's not a Mac, so Loris is going to struggle.
Loris is struggling right now. Unfortunately, Jessica's come to my rescue. We'll see. It's an application not found. I'm an adapter. No, it's just on a, it's on a regular flash drive.
Just do that USB 30 FD on the left hand side. Try
it. Right here.
Try that. Is that
there
it?
Go. No, this one.
No. Is that it?
Yep.
Double click.
Yeah. Okay.
That way, Shelly.
There we go. Chapter 21. Okay, I'm good. Thank you.
Well, should we repair it? This is
really you know what? Let me talk off of my thing. Off of my thing.
Hang on. I think I got you.
Oh, there we go. Okay. Okay, so anyway, all right. So I'm taking off, and where my concern has been is about ministerial, as you guys know, all right? So I pulled out here some information from the Iowa Public Information Board, and obviously the definition is the same as you know, from what Jessica said. Ministerial is... when there's no discussion of a, related to the deliberation of the meeting or discussion. Okay, and here from this Iowa Public Information Board, it appears that gathering for purely ministerial purposes may include a situation in which members of a governmental body gather simply to receive information on a matter within the scope of the body's policymaking duties. Well, going forward, as we discuss what kind of policy we may or may not want to implement here, is that just because we're receiving information that's the public's business, and we're usually receiving information that the public has paid for. And that was my argument there with the insurance. One reason why I felt uncomfortable if we didn't go ahead and post on the insurance on that. But that has to do with best practices, not the law itself.
So, Loris, you mind if
right.
we have a... So, I think I agree with that to the point, but it's not the public's business, nor is it appropriate for the public to know who slipped and fell, or who got, you know, bit by a rodent, or who, you know...
I agree.
So it changes... what information the board is able to receive collectively. And here's my concern, it's always better for us as one body, because we're one body. There's three individuals, but it's one board of supervisors. It's always better when we receive the same information at the same time, because there's less confusion about what is out there.
Okay, and I agree. And of course, the issue, as we ran into the Tedesco meeting, is that there was not an exemption under Chapter 21 for us just to do the closed session for that specific page in that report. And that's where we kind of moved forward. So that was the dilemma there. And then going back to even had we met in what would have started as the... you're saying it's a ministerial function. If you look at the italicized part,
here at the end. A meeting may develop if a majority of the members of a body engage in any discussion that focuses at all concretely on matters over which we may exercise judgment or discretion. And that's the thing that is key, especially with Marty being on the board less than a year, and I'm new on the board. And yes, I am able to exercise some self-control, but at the same time, I want to ask questions. I mean, if I'm meeting with someone about the public's business, I want to be able to ask that question. And it sounds like that if I'm asking that question, a response is given, it may be clarified to start, but if there's any feedback from one of the other two of you, all of a sudden, we've crossed over.
There's all kinds of opportunities to cross over,
yeah.
But that's the reason that in every one of those insurance meetings since I've been around, we've had either the assistant county attorney or the county attorney there. The other thing I'll say, and you remember this really, really well, so when I was appointed to the board back in 2010, I had a major concern with what was then the Monday morning meetings of the Board of Supervisors. So at that point, the Board of Supervisors would get together, and I want to say it was 8:30 on a Monday morning, and they would bring in, Deb, you guys didn't come in every week, did you? You kind of rotated where every other week, department heads would come in and give a full report to the board, which in and of itself would be fine, but there was a lot of discussion. I said it happened, I used to laugh about it, I used to say, you know, it literally happened in a back room. It happened in the conference room, and I watched one time, I remember vividly, it was the former IT director who came in and gave a phenomenal PowerPoint presentation, and it was on, it might have been on fiber optic. I mean, it was on some kind of technology that was coming to the county. And she probably gave a 21-page report on what was going on. And all three supervisors were there. I was sitting in the corner of the room as a candidate, which you've experienced before, right? And watching this thing, and the supervisors, it was a great discussion. They had a great discussion. Well, why would we do this, and why wouldn't we do that? And I'm breaking out into a sweat, because I just can't stand that this is happening. So the very next Tuesday, they come out here, and they have exactly the same presentation from this IT director. Exactly the same. There's no questions, there's no conversation, they pass it 3-0. Worse, I think you were in the audience that Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I was appointed, I didn't feel it was appropriate for me as an appointed supervisor to come in and say, oh, that's it, we're not doing any more Monday morning meetings. But I said very clearly, all right, I'll sit in on the Monday morning meetings, but if I ever feel like we're crossing the line to being in a open meeting, I'm out the door. And that's what I did until such time as I was elected, and then we didn't have Monday morning meetings anymore.
And the Monday morning meetings were interesting because when I first came on and was with the register, I immediately went down to the register, my bosses in the newsroom, and had a discussion about those. And we talked to our legal counsel even. And the only problem with them was that they were actually being posted on bulletin board. The problem was they weren't following the...
No minutes, no recording.
Right, no minutes, no recording, and they weren't being posted as far as who was going to talk about what topic, and you know, so legally there was an issue with them too, but thank you for making my point, Rick, because every meeting that occurs outside of a notice situation, a true notice situation, is a situation where a conversation isn't able to be heard. And certainly everything we do here on Tuesday morning, I mean, everybody over time, the public knows. But we're going to have other meetings where we can at least notice them correctly, and then the public may be able to show up, right?
But you and I had lunch together at snack time.
Mm-hmm.
We run into each other from time to time at Cafe Diem.
Right.
It's possible for this to happen anywhere, and it is relying upon the board,
right,
to make sure that we never cross that line to open to discussion or deliberation. And if we do, it has to stop right there.
I agree. And we had a lovely discussion at snack time about liver and onions. And we're both fans.
But that could have turned into, that could have very easily turned into.
And you're right. So we have to exhibit that control. When we know we're meeting with someone, as I said, I eventually want to head toward when we're discussing, when we know that we're meeting someone that is related to the county's business, Oh, and we're paying, especially if we're paying for it with the county money. And that was where the Tedesco thing came in, okay? So so anyway, I just pulled out from Dooley versus Johnson County, which County Attorney Reynolds already had talked about, was that, you know, this is what the actual court said. Gathering for this purpose appears dangerously close to deliberation. And in this situation, reminder, there was not a quorum there, okay? But there was an attempt to get information from a contractor, and they hadn't noticed it. And so I just wanted to remind that even the court is saying, look, even though we found that this was not in violation, it certainly was a poor decision. Yes, Marty?
Nothing. We're just displacing another meeting here coming up, so just, oh, nothing. I'm just
okay.
He was waving at people in the hallway.
Yeah,
All right. So there are the references I just used for what was up above. The rule of thumb for Chapter 21. Okay, here's where I'd like to go on our proposed goals. Commit to public involvement and transparency. I'd like to create processes targeted toward the public rather than internal timetables when practical. I'd like to develop standards for uniform agenda postings and content requirements. I'd like to adopt best practices even if they exceed minimum legal requirements. And to do that, moving ahead very quickly, is one of the proposals I'd like to put before the board that we can discuss and maybe go forward with, is create a committee to actually look at what best practices might be. Someone from the county attorney's office, someone from the auditor's office, you know, we can appoint a staff member from the board. I obviously would like to sit on it, but it, maybe what we need is instead one of the board, one of our employees to sit on it and then come back and, you know, I can filter from there. Enact policy incorporating all of the above, and then to integrate the policy into all the outreach and communication components. And so I'd like to show you just something Leanne and I did in an hour. Leanne did, and I sat and kind of asked her, you know, please do this. Right now, I think people could go on to our homepage. They see right away up there, agendas and minutes. They know how to go ahead and click. Prior to what Leanne did for me last week, is we had county budget and administration, but we didn't really post the work sessions all the time. Something like the economic development work session. We just posted the budget work sessions. In addition, we had what were the quadrant meetings all the way down at the bottom of the page. And most people then, when they sign up to follow the board, I don't think they realize they were only signing up for the Tuesday meetings that is staffed by by Shelley as our clerk, okay? And they didn't realize they weren't getting everything else. So then what we did, as now with the changes that Leanne made, when you click through, you go to this page and you see everything in its chronological order. And so that's just one example of how we can go ahead and do that. And it doesn't cost any more or time. So I'd just like to get us all on board to be committed to, besides Chapter 21, taking a look at when we are discussing public business, and also that we continue to move forward to make sure.
So I think any time that we discuss or deliver by law, it is an open meeting. I would suggest that, at least from my perspective, commit to public involvement and transparency. I think Story County, from before me, has been committed to public involvement and transparency. I don't think they always got it exactly right. I remember the website, when Paul and I came on the board, the website was really, really bad. I mean, it's not great now, but it was really, really bad, and there was no such thing as, Shelly, you didn't post audio, right? Somebody could come and get a CD from you if they wanted an audio, but audio wasn't readily available. We sure weren't recording anything, and so I think I can very clearly make the case that we already have a commitment. Now, does that mean that we don't want to continue to do better and better and better? Absolutely. But Morris, where you're going to lose me is if you consider everything a formal meeting, everything a public meeting, because I will still stand by. I think you and Marty, unfortunately, missed out by not getting that presentation from Nat Tedesco. I have more information than either of you do now, And even if you receive it at some point, even if Alyssa or Deb shares with you the specific information, you will not have received it in the same form that I received it. And I know for me as a supervisor, I would really dislike not having access to the information that I felt like I needed to be able to do my job.
I'd like to go back to how this all happened with NAP Tedesco, because one of the things that was very clear to me was we don't have an actual uniform, smooth way to handle a meeting like that. I came back from being sick for 4 days, or I'd have noticed it earlier, and we'd have had time to react and at least get it posted.
But it doesn't need to be posted, and that's the conversation you and I are having.
It did.
Well, but here's why I don't think it does, and she's leaned over talking right now, but I think the first question is always from a board of supervisors, here is this item. Is it a meeting? And if it's a meeting, then absolutely it needs to be posted, and we need to do a better job. No question about it. I appreciate the work you and Leanne put in. We need to do a better job making sure that Austin knows about every work session, right? There was a work session, Austin, that it wasn't that we didn't post it. It was that we didn't post it in a way that it was readily available to you. And I think we need to do a better job of that, and I'm all in. But where I push back is, if the question to the county attorney is it appropriate for the board together to receive this information? And the county attorney says, yes, it's appropriate. And not only is it appropriate, I'll be there. Where nothing's gonna cross the line. And it's beneficial to the board collectively to receive that information together. I think to do our jobs well, we've got to continue to have that ability.
To do our jobs well, we have to be able to not only receive the information, we have to be able to ask questions about it. And those questions are the minute that we go from a strict clarifying to some kind of conversation, we cross the line. And one way is, yes, to have the attorney there so we don't get in legal trouble, but it stops us from being able to have a conversation that, with the exception of that one page out of how many pages were in that report, 15, 20 pages, we weren't able to have that conversation because of the inclusion of one piece of paper that was quite frankly, I'm so sad that for some reason we couldn't have fit that into an exemption. For a Chapter 21, I know, I understand that. I think it's sad, and that the reason we couldn't discuss that piece of paper, even though there were no names there, but is because we couldn't bring in from another chapter the exemption that says.
Yeah, but we can't do what we can't do. We can't do what's not allowed.
Why wouldn't we want to have the rest of that conversation where all three of us could really have a conversation with our insurance agent? And why wouldn't the rest of that conversation have maybe been enlightening to the public?
Well, so having the meeting that would have included all three of us. And this is a great example, so I want to continue down this road.
It's a great example.
Having that conversation, if it had been the three of us probably sitting back here in our conference room,
right.
It probably been, so as it was me and Jessica and Alyssa and Deb meeting with members of NAP Tedesco, mm-hmm. and going through this and having receiving a really in-depth analysis of what's going on, what the trends are, how we're doing, and it's all really, really valuable. And now you and Marty are going to get a small piece of that since you weren't in it. You aren't going to get the full effect. And here's what bothers me about that. You are so inquisitive. This is a good thing, by the way. But what bothers me is you're so inquisitive that I don't have any doubt in my mind that if you had sat through that full meeting at the time we were having it, there would have been questions that would have come up in your mind. Not necessarily questions that would have been appropriate for you to ask at that point, but right now you don't even know that you have those questions.
That is correct, and all we had to do was pull that one piece of paper out of the
report. No, because it was more of a conversation than that. More than just that piece of paper, we're receiving information that is not suitable for the public. So what you're going to get, how long did we meet over there? Rough guess. Was it an hour and a half? It was an hour and a half. It's going to be a 15-minute presentation that we're going to get from NAP Tedesco. You guys are not going to have the same information.
How was there information that wasn't suitable for the public?
I can't talk about that right now. We're in public.
So you're, so then it was some information that could have been covered, that would have been exempted by chapter 21 then? Well, yeah, we're gonna have ongoing, I guess, problems with this, because how do we get information not suitable for the public that, but yet, this is somebody we employ and provides us a service? So we pay for that service, and certainly every dollar we spend is in fact the public's interest. And how we spend that dollar and how we make that decision about what vendors we choose is of the public's interest, and what service that vendor provides to us is of the public's interest. So I really am.
You're gonna get all that. You're gonna get all of that. You're not gonna get the detail of what's really going on. And the answer that I have to this is, let's trust our county attorney to give us good advice. Let's trust our county attorney to be part of any of those times that we get together to receive information. I'm not saying after the fact that we go to the county attorney and we say, oh, by the way, we had this meeting, now figure out how it works.
How did we know in advance, though, that this was going to be whatever this quasi-information is that we can't share in public?
Because that's what we have to do.
We do the same thing every year. We've been...
I guess I might have left the meeting anyway. I guess if there was something shared that I thought should have been shared with the public,
There's nothing unlawful in those meetings,
and Jessica sits through all of them, but see, what's different is, had we done it the way Story County traditionally did, completely appropriately, completely legally done it, you would have all that information right now. And if there was something in that meeting that you felt like was necessary to be shared with the public, you know what, you'd have that ability now.
But
maybe
inappropriately. But you don't feel that you have an obligation to share it with the public?
Yeah, I don't think 100% of the things we know get shared with the public. And the example I'll give you is, Leanne Harder really led a phenomenal process putting together the Coop Cup. How, you've read the Coop Cup, you've seen both now, the redacted version and the non-redacted version. Mm-hmm. What percentage of that book, Loris, is redacted?
Well,
85 or 90%?
Right.
That's not public. How much more information do you have once you saw the non-redacted version versus the redacted version?
Right.
That's part of the deal.
And you're saying the insurance, this discussion about insurance, included that type of information related to government operations that could put the government at risk of a true safety risk of not being able to function?
I'm not comparing that in terms of a safety risk to the government. I'm comparing that to a privacy risk for our employees, and knowing what kind of trends are out there and what we're seeing happening in regards to insurance, and what the trend lines are in other places that you can't have the public conversation about, and how Story County is doing, and strategically, where Story County may want to consider having a full conversation about where we go in the future. You've been part of all those. Am I missing on any of this? I know I start to make you queasy when I start to have some of these conversations. Am I missing on anything?
Why would strategy not be open to the public?
That's what I'm saying.
That's an
internal. We don't develop internal. So I go into those meetings. Every year we've had those meetings.
I'm
trying to figure.
There's no strategy because I'm there.
No conversation, no. But, Loris, you know me well enough to know. I go into every one of those meetings and I start thinking about, okay, where does the county need to go from here? And just because it's not talked about out there, now all of a sudden when we talk about it out here, everybody's dealing with the same information. I mean, we just spent 45 minutes today going through something on the research park, just in an effort from me to make sure you and Marty have as much of the same information as I have. Because that's the only way we're going to operate as a really efficient board. Is if we're going to have differences of opinion. I mean, as you and I have proven and will continue to prove, we're going to have differences of opinion. But we should start with the same exact information.
But I agree with you, and I'm coming back to this, that if we get information that we may use in the future, and I just heard you say that the information that you got was information we may use in the future because it's related to employee trends, it's related to strategy, etc. So I'm back to, I would have
in that meeting said, wait a minute here, are we discussing something?
No, that's different. That's different.
Deliberation and action are the distinction. I think this is helpful. You can receive information.
Can you go to the mic, I'm sorry?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. And I have a 2 o'clock, so I'm gonna.
Oh, sure.
But I think the distinction is discussion, deliberation, or action, and that is absolutely not allowed. And my presence in those meetings is for that purpose, to ensure that that's not allowed. You can receive as a group any information.
Even information that we may, in the future, discuss, deliberate, or decide on. Exactly.
Exactly. But it is that threat that you and I have discussed about, if you're not careful when you're receiving the information, you just start kind of talking to each other. Well, hey, isn't that? Then you can cross over from a ministerial gathering to an open meeting.
Okay. And I want to go back and re-look at Dooley, because didn't Dooley talk about information in itself that's going to be used in the future?
You can receive information, you can't discuss, deliberate, or take action.
But Dooley didn't talk about.
It doesn't prohibit that. And that is my legal opinion based on my experience, which I have a great deal of in this area.
Yep. And so for me, Loris, what it comes down to is, so I tend to drive a little faster than I should sometimes. And that Suburban that I drive will move at a pretty good pace if I'm not careful. Now, the speed limit between here and Des Moines on the interstate is 70 miles an hour, right? And I try really hard to go 70 miles an hour. And there is real danger, knowing how I tend to do things and knowing how fast that vehicle will go, that I may speed up and go faster than 70 miles an hour. If I do that, I'm at fault. But the fact that I should only be able to go 70 miles an hour doesn't mean I ought to drive at 45 just to be safe that I'm not going to. And if I choose to go over 70, or if I accidentally go over 70, I'm at fault. And that's the way I view about a non-meeting, that insurance meeting. If we had been poor enough, if our county attorney, if we had been together and we had taken it from being an appropriate meeting to being an inappropriate meeting, that's on us. And if our county attorney had been there and not recognized that it was moving to inappropriate, that's on us. And for us to hamstring our ability to operate when what we're doing is completely legal, completely legitimate, in trying to make sure that everybody receives the same information at the same time. We don't do anything with it at that point, but we receive the same information. I think we can never be as effective a board as possible to be, knowing that we got the differences of opinion that we got up here, all three. We gotta start with common ground, and common ground is getting information.
Yes, and I don't think we can ever be effective as long as we can't have those conversations when we've got the vendor.
You can always bring the vendor back in. Well, I mean, we're doing it this time. You're going to be able to ask Steve Goodhue anything you want to ask him, but you're starting from a point of not having the same information. Because even if you go to Deb, Alyssa, Jessica, you can't come to me. You go to one of those. They're going to give you every piece of information that they remember, but you did not receive it at that time, in that context, with the depth that I received. It's different.
Well, okay, so moving forward here on, because, I mean, you and I are not going to agree about this. I mean, I really feel we are obligated. It's not just with legal or not. All right, it's what we're obligated to do, what we were elected to do, which is conduct the people's business in the light of day. And so there's going to be a disagreement between you and I. I'm hoping there are not a whole lot of these meetings where I'm not going to be attending them if I really feel uncomfortable about this.
Yeah, and so.
I appreciate that distinction. I think it's really important for me before I leave to go to my 2 o'clock that legal versus policy distinction is made, because you know my role is what's legal, and that's quite frankly not hard for me to determine. I got a lot of guidance.
Sure.
And then I think the board's challenge, from what I'm hearing sitting here, is policy wise do you decide to go above and beyond the legal requirements? And so that will be an ongoing conversation, it sounds like, and it's a good conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this board can decide that we're just not going to collectively receive the same level of information that traditionally we have received. So I think you're right. We were elected by the people of Story County to represent them doing the county's business. But that doesn't mean that all 97,000 of them get to have exactly the same information in all cases. It means they need to be able to see exactly how we discuss, deliberate, and make decisions. But it doesn't mean that they get to have the same information we have exactly when we get to have it. That's why they elected us. That's why we're not a true and complete democracy, right? Where everybody gets to weigh in on every single issue. That's not the way it works. They elect the three of us, and the second they want to elect a different one of us, they elect a different one of us.
I don't obviously hold that same view, okay? I find that, but that's, at this point, and they're waiting for the room, and everybody is okay. Marty, you haven't weighed in at all. I still have asked what the next steps would be. What do you think the next steps should be?
Well, I tell you, I'm pleased beyond words to say that you would take on the clunky website we've got. Having to put ourselves out there, I'm kind of surprised when you first sign in and you start looking at the tools that the county provides. That was terrible. It still is. It's getting better, but it needs to be done. We bring collective experiences that to the table. You often speak as a journalist. Well, I'll sit here as a 10-year board president of the school board, and we do reviews with our insurance providers, and these things are offered up to us, you know, individually, collectively. And you're brought up there in a position of leadership as you get the whys and the what fors, because often some of the information they provide tell you why you got to what you pay. And I guess without going too deep into that piece of paper, that tells you why you have the rates you got. And there's just some information that, you know, we're looking at, you have things are in motion, some things are settled, some things are pending, some things are litigated. And there's just, I'm not comfortable putting myself in a position to say this is going to be a public document, because frankly it's not. And that's my experience, and I would only hope that you validate it and take it for, as I defer to you as a journalist, defer to me as an elected official doing just this. That's the experience I bring to the table. Those are the eyes that I give to this issue.
So the question I've asked, or I propose, that we develop a committee from people with these different departments to take a look at what would be best practices.
And my stance is, so I guess the first thing I would say is, I don't think you and I are that far off. When it comes to us in our legislative role, I'm with you 100%. I'm just afraid you're not looking at us in our executive role. And the Board of Supervisors have two, I mean, it's an interesting dichotomy that they ask us to do in the legislative role and the executive role. And in our executive role, we have some gatherings that are not meetings. By law, they're just not meetings. And so my contention is, Story County is already going above and beyond the law. We already do more. And I feel very strongly in this one case, talking about insurance, that we made a mistake collectively as a board, and you and Marty not being included in that information. And there's no way that I can get to that you guys can be included unless we do it exactly the way we've been doing it. And I hear you very clearly, Loris, that you're not willing to do that. And so I don't have a great answer for that, but I would say this. Here's my thought of best practices. We continue to be absolutely committed to adhering to the open meetings, open records law, and we go beyond it. We put videotape out. We make sure that you help get our website cleaned up and user-friendly. You and I have talked about it a couple times. It's not enough just to have the information passively available. We got to make it readily available to the public, and I'm all in on that. And then my suggestion would be, anytime we have a question, anytime we have something pop up that we might need to meet on, that we're uncertain about where to go, we refer it to the county attorney's office and say, county attorney's office, give us advice on how we head to this. And if in fact we decide it's not a meeting, but the three of us are going to be together receiving information, we make sure we have somebody from the county attorney's office there, part of the meeting completely to ensure that we don't get anywhere close to crossing a line we don't want to cross.
We met with the Farm Bureau on Thursday night. There were three of us there. The Farm Bureau, we presented information about what was going on in the county, We discussed what was going to come up in the future, and the Farm Bureau lobbied us on basically cables, okay? So, do we have a meeting or did we not?
Well, I will say that these issues are very fact-specific. So I want to look at that in its entirety. I wasn't included in...
Well, no, because they don't think...
It was posted.
It was posted. We posted it. I was pretty adamant about that we posted.
So I think it sounds like you all appeared to present together.
Well, one after the other, we each took our turns.
I never spoke on CAFOs until the meeting broke out.
Well, we didn't present on CAFOs. We presented on here what's happening on the county. What do we see? What are what are we going to do in the future? I talked about a little bit about what I'd like to look at with housing and roads and Rick talked about what might be coming up with that county budget. And I mean,
okay, so you provide information. Did the three of you deliberate or take action?
No, but to me that was a discussion.
Well, I think that we were having the opportunity for the...
Together, so you all, hey, this is what I think on CAFOs, this is what I think on CAFOs, this is where I'm going with you.
No.
So I think there is a lawful distinction, and again, the way I view this conversation is that you've got the legal requirements, which is what I know. And then I think there's a desire to maybe exceed the legal requirements on your part, like you're talking about best practices and policy decisions. And I think, you know, when you and I talk about these things, I think that's where the difference is. Legally, it sounds to me like it wasn't really to be able to do what I'm hearing. Discussion, deliberation, that's where my mind is legally. But does that mean that you can't post it? Absolutely not. I mean, you can decide.
No, I think that was, so for me, Loris, I think that one was completely appropriate that we posted it. But that's not what the tradition of Story County has been. It has been one supervisor, generally the chair, attending that Farm Bureau meeting, and I think you and Marty rightly pointed out, hey, we're new to the board, we want to go to this meeting, and you said, let's post it, and I thought that was completely appropriate.
Doesn't sound like, again, this is me taking these women back, doesn't sound to me like discussion, deliberation, action between the three of you happened, and therefore the law would require that. But that doesn't mean that you can't do it, which it sounds like is what you did anyway.
So how, if we don't have a policy, okay, coming back to differences about what, if we don't have some kind of policy about how, about what circumstances we are going to post on, and from that then, because then part of what I ran into is the auditor's office said they wouldn't post something like that, so we had to go to Leanne instead. So we've got a gap in our process too. And so from that standpoint, we've got, if we don't have a policy, if we don't have a policy, then how are we going to develop a process? And how are we going to know as we go forward? Are we going to have this look?
We got a process.
Sorry.
We post, absolutely. Jessica, you've been very helpful. You've been really helpful. Thank you.
All right, then. Have a good day.
We've got an existing process for us. It is we post all meetings, and we don't post non-meetings. And if there's a question about whether it's a meeting or a non-meeting, we go to the county attorney's office to get a determination. That's our process.
And I just feel that, I mean, we're back to the activities that will occur in a non-meeting. All right, this goes back to this insurance one. Would it have been nice that we all three were there? Certainly it would have been good information, but I don't feel like going to a meeting.
You've proven that you're going to go above and beyond, up to and including, I don't know if we said this publicly yet, up to and including getting in a motor grader to observe plowing snow at 2 a.m. You've proven, Loris, already in your mind that you're willing to go above and beyond. So that's not the question. The question is, how are you going to reconcile the reality that you're both a legislative body, member of a legislative body and an executive body, and there are very clear differences in those two roles?
Well, that you're right. How am I going to reconcile it? I think that both of them, being in the government are requiring them still the old business. I don't think there's that much of a difference. There are some things we know that we need to keep personnel, okay? We know that we need to keep private.
Well, so it sounds to me like, though, you're saying there's only two possibilities. There's either an open meeting or a closed meeting. And I'm saying there's a third possibility. There's a non-meeting. A non-meeting that has the three of us present. Jessica has very clearly laid out that legally, there clearly is that.
Legally.
You're suggesting that we should operate where it's either an open meeting or a closed meeting. And the problem with that is there is absolutely no way to take an open meeting to a closed meeting unless it is one of those things that's allowable to close a meeting. So the second you start to have it, it changes the information you can receive appropriately.
Right, and then we're back to, for me, I can't conceive of almost any information that would not be appropriate for us to receive in front of other people. Yeah. I know you say there is, but...
No, I'm fine with, so sitting here as the chair right now, I'm fine if you want me as the chair to be the one receiving that additional information. That's fine. Where I'm not going to be fine is one day when I'm not chair and somebody else is getting the information that I feel like I need to have in the same context that they got it, and that's where it's going to get interesting down the road.
But I'm not saying I don't need the information also. I'm just back to saying that the information involved with the public's business is actually open information. And otherwise, what you're being given, if it's not state secrets, then it's the type of stuff I do think that down the road we will use to have discussions on. So I understand where you're sitting. I've asked if anybody would support me in a policy and going forward, and I hear no. This is what I just got out of you guys, is that no, we're doing more than we need to do now. And that's what I've heard from.
I think we should consider to continue to monitor this. And so we've had exactly two in our month. We've had two, right? We had one that was never intended to have more than one of us attend, that three of us attended, and we posted that, and that's the Farm Bureau. And we had one that was intended for the three of us to attend that we weren't going to post, and so we ended up with just one of us attend. And I would say we continue to follow this pathway and see if this is really an issue. First of all, you get to where you've got it reconciled in your head. Here's the reality, and I mean this, I think you agree with this. You learn more about sitting on this side of the table every single day, right? I mean, you just do. And reconciling that with the reality of how you spend a majority of your adult life sitting on the other side reporting on what's going on this side is a little different.
But it doesn't change my basic beliefs or my ethics. I got into my profession because of what I believed about government.
100%.
And how, whether it be legislative or executive, it should be run, not the other way around. So
sure. Absolutely, but you have to have seen in your years that there are things that occur in government that not only appropriately, but necessarily, Austin doesn't get to know about, right? And the people that Austin writes for doesn't get to know about, and the people that you wrote for with the Des Moines Register and Ames News Online didn't get to know, and I go back to the Coop Cog for that, Morris. You've seen both versions.
The Coop Cog is clearly, it also is that type of, we talked about earlier, proprietary information. I mean, it's information proprietary to us be able to operate in an emergency, right? That's the Coop Cog. And so you're telling me that you heard things sitting in that meeting that truly affect our ability to operate as a company.
I think I would agree to that we're proprietary. I would agree to that, because some of the things that are not noticed in the Coop Cog have nothing to do with the county's ability to operate. They have to do with privacy of our employees, things like cell phone lists. Things, you know, think about some of the things that are in there, and I'm saying it's a lot more comparable to stuff like that than it is, oh, how's the county going to operate if we get hit with an F5 tornado? That's what I'm saying. I think it's a great conversation. I think this is one of those areas that is going to make it entertaining for Austin here over the next week.
I don't, you know, I'm not here to entertain Austin, though, or anybody else.
No, but, and I'm sorry you're frustrated, because this is part of the deal, that we're going to have conversations like
this. Right, but please, do not denigrate it down to that level. I understand, we disagree,
sure.
Yes.
Yeah, but there was nothing denigrating about that, Boris. The reality is, you and I have a different viewpoint, and you covered this board for a long, long time. It's much more interesting to cover a board that has some differing viewpoints than a board that tends to agree on everything. So don't take it as denigration, and don't let your frustration that we didn't agree with you turn into something more than it is. I am showing, I hope you're seeing how much I appreciate what you put in. I'm just allowed to appreciate it and still disagree with it.
Of course you will. Of course you will. I have great discipline.
Okay. All right, so we are now to departmental reports, none. Other reports, none. Public forum number two, opportunities for members of the public to address topics not on today's agenda. We won't take any action due to the open meetings law, which is fortuitous. And yeah, come on.
You don't want any more time, so I'll send you an email. Just don't reply to all.
Thanks, Linda. Liaison assignments, Marty.
Got drainage district here. We'd like to go to. We got the employees' appreciation, and I guess it kind of escapes me. I'm deep into mentally going through what we've been through. So don't have everything, but that's all I got for
you. Okay, Loris.
I'm here with Marion Cressy from Boost. Boost is undergoing a 4.25% reduction immediately, and they anticipate that next year's budget will include that same 4.25%. I think, and then moving forward, yeah, we've got employee recognition. We have the Story County Assessor, and let's see. So that's it for liaison.
Okay, good. For me, Conservation Board last night, really, really good meeting. Actually, Linda was there. You stayed for all of it, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Linda was there for all of it. And I guess the big takeaway that I would have is no cabins in next year's budget. So I've talked to Lisa Markley about what kind of budget we're going to publish, but no cabins in next year's budget was the big takeaway from last night. Announcements, Marta.
No.
Lawrence.
I was contacted, I've been contacted by several different constituents this week. Of course, there's great upset about what's going on down in Des Moines with the collective bargaining. I also was contacted as a result of that. The Ames Chamber and Ames Economic Development Commission had weighed in as lobbying for that bill. And some people were concerned that we had a contract with such an agency, but they have now changed that to uncommitted, I guess. So based on some feedback that they received from a lot of people. I had a meeting on Monday with a woman here in Nevada whose church group has started something called Common Ground, and they are going out voluntarily meeting all kinds of needs in the Nevada community, including they're providing transportation to residents to get to medical appointments and getting to into Ames for various things. And so I've asked her to send me, she'd already talked to United Way and had applied for some money, didn't get it, but I've asked for that information to be sent to see if that's something to, you know, talk to them further about. So that's pretty much.
That's worthy of support. Mm-hmm. See if you reach out.
So that's.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how you develop some of those possible things. I don't have any, so I take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Return.